The stories written by Jane Gardam and read by Phyllida Nash and John Telfer. Introduction. I have always preferred writing short stories to writing novels. Not that there is much similarity, and not that a writer can usually get away with writing only one or the other. Catherine Mansfield almost did. Stories of all lengths and depths come from mysterious parts of the cave. The difference in writing them is that for a novel, you must lay in mental, physical, and spiritual provision, as for a siege or for a time of hectic explosions, while a short story is, or can be, a steady, timed flame like the lighting of a blow lamp on a building site full of dry tinder. For me, it was James Joyce's Dubliners, written in 1921, 7 years before I was born, that showed me how, or at any rate, that short stories can have the power to burn up the chaff, harden the steel without comment or embellishment or explanation. I like Irish, French, Russian, and American short stories best. They are the strongest. Human beings, it seems to me, are dependent on story. Stories painted on cave walls, sung on jangling instruments, chanted or spoken in lullaby from their beginnings. Children deprived of stories grow up bewildered by their own boredom. My own first awareness of stories was when I was 4 years old, listening to my mother as we sat at my bedroom window and I writhed and wriggled on her knee, as children do when they listen without looking. I had just lately realised that the marks in the middle of the small, shiny pages of Beatrix Potter's The Tale of Peter Rabbit were words. They had sounds invisibly attached. Attaching the sounds to the marks was called reading. Pictures were great, but they were extras. It was a moment of joy. At the same time, it was a moment of disquiet, for above my head, at the window behind the curtain, there was something terrible. I couldn't see it, but I knew that it was there. "Will you please sit still?" "But there's something there behind the curtain. Don't be silly." I jumped up and tweaked the curtain, and behind it sat a disgusting, freckled, blackish parrot with loose-skinned, leathery claws. I knew that parrot was death. I wriggled on. Out of the window, the huge sky, the weedy railway line, the space between two empty, shabby mansions, the distant Cleveland hills. 8 years later, 1940, I was sitting doing my homework, and still I didn't care to look up at that curtain, when a little aeroplane flew past, very low. It had a swastika on its side, and I could see the dark round bullet of the pilot's helmet. I shrieked out, "There's an enemy plane!" Up from the kitchen came the command not to be silly, when from somewhere near the steelworks to the north of us came the most almighty explosion. The dangerous presence was still there. 5 years ago, at 80, I went to look at my old home again, and it looked exactly the same as in the 30s. Beautifully kept, polished door knocker and letterbox, rows of perfect antirrhinums, straight as pink soldiers, except that I found I could still only manage a quick glance at my bedroom window, now covered in net. I found myself shaking. "Jane has always had her ecstatic side," my mother used to say, "and ecstasy is all very well, but..." It wasn't ecstasy that got me away from the burden of home. It was English literature and an award to London University that set my ecstatic side aflame. Then it went out. The work was dreary, heavy with Anglo-Saxon, and there was no money for theatres or extra food. Though I didn't admit it, I was bored, except for when I was in the wonderful but ice-cold Bedford College library. No coal or heating in the 40s. At school, the domestic science mistress, who was vague about geography, had asked me when I reached London to go and visit her niece, newly arrived from the colonies and very shy. Her school was near Reading, which she pronounced as in Reading, and that sounded promisingly like a suburb of London. I nearly turned back when I found the train fare was 10 shillings. I used my last faded banknote. And then I was greatly humbled by the schoolgirl niece herself, who looked all of 21, wore wonderful clothes, was bronzed by African sun, and was clearly not homesick at all. She didn't know what to do with me. Desperately, she said there was a lecture that afternoon by L.A.G. Strong, a well-known critic then, on the short story. Would I like to come to it? I had read his book, The Short Story, at school, and what he thought, I thought too. In it, he says, think of the reader, not yourself. Make everything interesting. Write about everything, even linoleum. On the way back to the London train, I followed L.A.G. Strong. I climbed into the same carriage. I sat down beside him. He looked dejected and tired, with deep lines between his nose and his sweet mouth. I fell in love. I began to talk. This may sound like nothing, but for me, almost pathologically self-conscious, it was like removing all my clothes and belly dancing. In time, he said, I believe you write. And I said, yes. Send me something. Looking weary, he courteously passed me a card. I went back to college, ecstasy in the ascendant, and sent him a short story called The Woman Who Lost a Thought. And I have it yet. And waited. Silence. Silence for 2 weeks. Then a letter typed in royal blue ink. Jane, you are a writer beyond all possible doubt. And for a while, I stayed with short stories. The first volume of them was about children on a white beach, and I called it A Few Fair Days. I posted it in a letterbox on the corner of Murray Road in Wimbledon. After 3 weeks, I telephoned the publisher and asked if she was going to accept them, as there were other publishers who might like them. Astounded silence. The publisher, at Hamish Hamilton, said afterwards that she had told her secretary there was a mad woman on the phone, and would she find her manuscript and send it back? The secretary found it in the 3-foot-high pile of unsolicited manuscripts and said, do you know, I think these might just do. I have written and published 8 or 9 collections of short stories and 10 novels since then. One won the Catherine Mansfield Award, 2 won the Whitbread, and another was a collection about Jamaica, where I had only spent 16 days, and it won nothing. I was getting rather above myself. These early stories are somewhat wild. Then a new publisher asked for a collection with more stories, if you think you can, and I airily said, of course. I don't think this was true. I turned for some years to novels and harder work and was shortlisted for the Booker Prize. Writing fiction has been my life for the past 40 years. I finished what I thought should be my last book a year ago, the final novel of a trilogy called Old Filth. Last Friends is a novel, but I like to think it has short stories embedded. When I finished Farewell, I said, Amen. I must learn when to stop. That is what short stories teach you. Yet perhaps the most gratifying thing since writing this book and its 2 companion volumes before, which have taken 8 years, was the phone call this year from my most faithful and enduring publisher, Richard Beswick of Little Brown. He asked for a big chunky anthology of all your favourite short stories. I said that I understood that nobody wanted to read short stories now, but he said, you are wrong. Look around. Choose your favourites. Times are changing once again. The deathly parrot recedes. Maybe he was never there. How much more and how much better I might have written had I not been so timid. Reading Claire Tomlin's Thomas Hardy, The Time-Torn Man, the other day, I came upon the ballad of The Outlandish Knight, where the heroine escapes death and returns home to safety. There is nobody there but a parrot in the window. I swear I had not read this poem at 4 years old. The parrot being up in the window so high, and hearing the lady did say, I'm afraid some ruffian has led you astray, that you've tarried so long away. Well, the parrot is vanquished and the ecstasy is now fitful. The luck in the writer's life always is to have been able to use sweets of fiction to get near the truth. Jane Gardam, May 2014. Hetty Sleeping. Seeing the tall man's long back, she thought, with a lurch, it's like Henniker's back. Then, as he turned round, she saw that it was Henniker. He was standing on a pale strip of sand near the sea, looking down into the cold water, quiet, as he had always been, peaceful, unmistakable. How could it be? She thought. What nonsense. Of course it can't be. She went on folding the T-shirts and jeans, gathering flung sandals, and then made two neat heaps with a towel on each, for when the children came out of the sea. She took off her cardigan, pushed her hands back through her hair, gave her face for a moment to the sun, looked again. She watched her two children run with drumming feet over the hard white strand, splash past the man into the sea, fling themselves into it in fans of spray, shrieking. Then she looked at the man again. Long brown legs, long brown back. He was watching with a painter's concentration the movement of the water and the shapes of the children playing in it. 20, 30 yards away, yet she could not mistake the slow smile, the acceptance as he narrowed his eyes and looked at lines and planes and shadows, that there are wonders on the earth. It was Henniker, all right. 10 years older, but decidedly and only Henniker. He turned, came up the beach, dropped down beside her and said, "Hello." He was wearing black swimming trunks and had a beard. Funny, she thought. I always laugh at beards in the sea, but he looks all right. He always did look all right. Wherever he was. "Hello," she said. He hadn't said her name. Perhaps he'd forgotten it. He had never used people's names much. He had been cautious, except in his work. "Hello, Hetty," he said. "It's a long time." "It's a funny place," she said. He smiled, not looking away from her face. "To meet again," she said. "It's a long way from Earl's Court. Connemara." "A holiday," he said gently, and began to take the sand and sift it through his fingers. Her heart started to lurch again, seeing his fingers. "I know each nail," she thought. "I know each line on them. Every half moon. Oh, God." There was a shriek from the sea and he looked over his brown shoulder at the children. "Yours," he said. "Yes," she began to babble. "They're 8 and 4, Andy and Sophie. We're here for a fortnight. We've taken a house."
"And their papa?"
"He's following. He was to have come with us, but at the last minute there was a crisis. We came ahead. We'd booked the house, you see. The Pin."
"The Pin? Lord Thing's house? Ballinhead?"
"Yes. It's a fishing lodge."
"I know."
He swung round onto his stomach and got hold of her bare feet and held them tight. "Hetty," he said, looking closely at her toes.
"Wonderful feet," he said. "They always were. I once drew your feet." "So you've married brass?"
"No," she said. "When we married, there was no brass at all. He's clever. He's good. At his job. Marvellous, if you want to know."
"Top brass?"
"Not at all. Don't be silly. I was a painter. Would I have married top brass?"
"Very silly not to, if you had the chance. Colonel and Lady Top Brass, VC, XYZ and Bar. Are you Lady Brass? You look it a bit, with your white, white skin."
"Don't be silly." He held her feet tight and put his forehead against them.
Lord and Lady Top Brass and all the little alloys. Shut up! This can't be happening. We arrived yesterday. We've hardly been here 10 minutes. Henneker. She tried to free her feet and giggled. You're tickling, she said. Don't breathe over me. He let go of her feet and said,
What is he then?
A banker.
Christ.
Do you know any bankers? Men with international work?
No, thank God. Men with international work. Do you know any painters still?
No, she said.
Do you do any painting?
After a long time, she said no. He lay flat on his back now on the sand and spread his arms far out and closed his eyes. His bearded, gentle face and fine nose and peaceful expression were like an icon. She thought, he ought to be picked out in jewels, he's so beautiful. He's wicked as ever. Oh, God, I love him. And getting up, she gathered the two heaps of clothes with a swoosh into the beach bag, and the cardigan and her book and the towels in her arms, and was off down the beach to the sea's edge. I'm moving, she called to the children. I'm going back up to the car. Don't be long, darlings. 10 minutes. But we just got in. We were staying in all morning. There's a wind. But it's lovely. No, it's cold. I'm moving out of the wind. There's not a breath of wind, shouted Andy. Not a bit. You're crazy. It's a boiling day. I'll be up in the car. And resolutely, not looking back, she tramped up the beach alone and sat by the car in the sharp grass, among old picnic papers where red ants nipped her and noisy wild dogs from the fishermen's cabins came and barked endlessly for food as she pretended to read. She was bathing Sophie at the pin that evening in water that foamed like Guinness into the noble old Guinness-stained bathtub, when a noise of thundering hooves began to rock the bathroom ceiling and the water from the tap turned to a trickle and died. Now what? Hetty sat back on her heels. £60 a week. £60 a week. The phone is dead, the electrics flicker, and the beastly peat. And now this. Whatever is it? Andy came flying in. I don't know. I think it's the boiler or something. I think it's dry. The water's hot as hot. Yes, but it stopped coming. The tank must be empty. It comes from that bog thing in the grounds. We saw it yesterday. I thought it looked awfully shallow. It looked awfully dirty, said Andy. And so does the bath. No, it's lovely brown water, she said. But, oh, I expect it'll all blow up soon, said Andy. Shall I go and throw the main switch? It might be safer. No. Shush. Let me think. Above the kitchen door, that great heavy big one. No. Oh, do shut up. Let me think. There's the pub. We might go to the pub. There might be a man. There is a man. At the pub? No, here.
Here?
Yes, in the hall place. He's that man on the beach. He's playing with our plasticine. Wait, I'll ask him. Hetty, on a cane chair by the bathroom window, with Sophie wrapped in a towel on her knee, saw Andy and Henneker walking thoughtfully together, hand in hand, through the wild garden towards the source of the bathwater. The thunder in the roof, however, continued. When she brought Sophie down the stairs, Henneker was at the big trestle table in the hall, making a plasticine dinosaur, and without looking up, said,
There seemed nothing wrong down there. Must be a block in the pipe.
She sat down with Sophie at the far end of the table, and the booming grew less, then less still, and finally stopped. A blessed trickle into the tank could be heard.
He said, Irish plumbing.
Sophie, eating biscuits, sidled round to him and watched his fingers. And Andy, who had been having his bath, which for safety's sake had been Sophie's not run out, came down again and leaned against Henneker, watching the emergence from the Pleistocene of a fat porcupine on elephant's legs, armour-plated on the stomach and with a rhino's spike. Sophie, coming closer, gazed at it with love.
"Could I have it?" said Andy.
"Someone can," said Henniker.
He put it in the middle of the table with its nose in a bowl of fuchsias.
"Thirsty," said Sophie. "Poor pig."
"It's not a pig. It's a... What is it, Henniker?"
"It's a swamp wanderer."
"What's that?"
"It wanders through swamps. It squelches through bogs. It thunders in roofs."
They squealed with joy.
"Now then," said Hetty, "bedtime."
Henniker made a roaring and thundering noise. They clung to him.
"Bedtime," Hetty said, hearing her surrey voice. "Now that will do. You're overexcited. Go to bed."
"Oh, please, no. If Daddy were here, he's not. Can't we stay?"
"Off," said Henniker. "Quick, before the squelcher gets you."
They fled. Sophie, stopping on the bend in the stairs, minute, delectable in a flowery nightgown.
"You won't go away. You'll come back tomorrow."
"Yes," said Henniker.
She brought coffee to the sitting room, where he was sitting in one of the two comfortable, shabby armchairs and watching the crumbling peat fire. Four long windows lit the chintz sofa, the shelves of Lord Thing's books about fishing and birds. Outside shone the Irish night, black and silver, with long, bumpy spars of land running out towards America. Not a sound anywhere, never a light moving along the road. There was the sense that all about the holiday house lay miles of silence, darkness, the ancient mountains inland making a long barricade against the usual world. Henniker's face, as he sat far back in his chair, was in shadow. She put the coffee between them on the stool and leaned back in her chair too. They did not speak for a long time.
"It might have been like this," he said at last.
She felt her heart begin to thump and hung on to the chair. "This is Henniker. Henniker I have thought of every day."
"No," she said.
He said,
"Yes. Oh, God."
"You never asked me," she said. "Not once."
"Well, you know why."
"I don't know why."
"Oh, Hetty."
"I don't know why. I never knew why. I couldn't ask you. All that year. That room, the bed made out of ropes, the roof like a greenhouse, and the curtain over the corner."
"Where our clothes were."
"No, our clothes were in heaps. Well, your clothes were in heaps."
"I loved your clothes," he said, "always clean and neat
and small.
All the buttons were real buttons with proper buttonholes."
"I used to gather up yours," she said, "like gleaning. A sock here, a shirt there, a shoe on the light."
"On the light?"
"Yes, to dim it down. Very dangerous."
"And smelly," she laughed.
"Oh, go on," he said. "What?"
"Laughing," he said. "I'd forgotten."
"And now you're famous," she said, looking up at him. He had stood up, all the long length of him, resting his forehead against his arm on the high chimney-piece and looking down at the grey fire. "Henniker man."
"What a piece of work is man."
"Have you..."
"Yes, I've been to all of them."
"Exhibitions," he said. "God knows what they amount to, really. I was doing better stuff that year."
"No," she said, "you are very much better now." He still says things in order to be contradicted. He knows I will contradict. He knows that I know that he needs to be contradicted. Our thoughts move completely together. They always did. We sit here. We are like Darby and Joan. And it's 10 years. He's wicked still, of course. I suppose he's married.
I wonder. She's a painter, he said to the fire. Hetty said nothing.
She's a painter, Lady Topbrass, just a painter.
Well, I suppose so. She would have had to be.
No, you know that. All that year you knew.
I didn't. Anyway, I was a painter.
No, you picked up my clothes, took the shoe off the light.
Good painters are often tidy. Usually, in fact. You must have been reading novels about painters, Henniker.
No, he said, not tidy like you. The tidiness was growing, it was getting dangerous. It got in the way.
Not often, she said. As time went on, you weren't there to see. I tidied round nothing and nobody. You were always out, later and later, more and more.
You should have painted instead. If you'd painted then, instead of minding and tidying.
He flung away and looked out of a window at the gigantic sea.
God, I missed you.
One of the children called out upstairs, and in a second she was out of her chair and the room and gone. Sophie lay like a seraph, her face lifted to the moonlight, but Andy was flinging about in a heap, one arm flailing the air.
A spike, he cried. Kill it!
All right, she said. Hush. Wake up a minute.
Beast, he cried. Thump it!
It's just a dream, she said. You're asleep. You're sleeping, remembering the water tank. Huh? He said, and, turning into a hump, was asleep again. She stood looking at herself in the glass at the top of the stairs, put back a strand of hair. 31, she thought. Honestly, you wouldn't think so. She felt gloriously happy, drifted back to the sitting room. But Henniker was gone.
After all, it was you left me, he said.
No, she folded clothes. The children splashed, called, Henniker, come and look, crabs, Henniker.
Soon, he said.
He sat on a rock with a towel round his neck. She sat a little below him on the sand, his bare brown legs from knee to ankle beside her shoulder, as she pushed Andy's socks into sandals. It was next day, still boiling, still un-Irishly hot.
Your parting, he said, is very beautiful.
Was, I suppose.
No, is. Your parting now, I mean, in your hair. All the hairs are bending back and shining down each side.
Oh, Henniker! Why is it that when he decides not to touch you, it's as good as other men touching you? Better. I thought you never liked my hair.
I never said that. Just thought it was too symmetrical in those days. Over nice. Better now.
I wasn't over nice in the end.
Indeed, no, said Henniker. It was you left me, as I remarked.
He slid down off the rock and sat beside her.
And got married, he said, leaning the back of his head against the rock he had been sitting on. About 10 minutes later. God knows all about it, I suppose. I didn't. The boy next door, number 3 in the Times, wedding in Scotland among all the dowdy dowagers, to which I was not invited.
Hardly.
Incidentally, is dowager a derivative of dowdy? One should look it up. Will you be a dowager? I'll marry you.
You're being cruel, she began to get up.
Stop.
The long brown hand, 10 years older but as familiar as her own, at last fastened over hers.
Stop. Don't go.
Why the hell shouldn't I?
Don't go with your white, white skin.
If I'm dowdy...
Oh, Het, shut up.
They sat on the almost empty strand. Some Dubliners far across were assembling a boat. There were one or two other people, Two fishermen trudged up from the day's work, carrying a plastic bag with heavy fish in it, staining the bag with blood. They were dressed in ageless clothes. They had very ancient faces. But for the plastic bags, they might have been ghosts. They walked up past Sophie and Andy, who were digging a fortress, Sophie patting the top of a Norman keep with a little pink spade. Her forearms were gold.
"'Tis a beautiful day," said the older fisherman as they passed by. "'You have beautiful children," the younger fisherman looked at Hetty.
They went on up the beach.
"'I love you so," said Henniker.
She pulled hard against his tightening hand. "'So what did you do?" she asked in the end. He was leaning back still with eyes closed.
Got married, I suppose.
Suppose? You must know. To the one who... To the one you were...
No, he said, sitting up, not her.
Well, to a painter.
Yes, to a bloody good painter, if it is of any interest to you.
Andy came up and flung down crabs. Sophie fell on a squishy thing and cried.
Comfort, handkerchiefs. Clothes, home for lunch and the children's rest.
Henniker back to the pub where he was staying. Will you come up after and do plasticine beasts, Henniker?
Yes, all right, Andy. 7:30?
I was supposed to be a bloody good painter too. She put down the coffee tray again between them, tried to brighten the fire, opened the curtains wider to the evening sea. Until I met you.
That's what I mean.
You destroyed it. She poured the coffee into mugs. That's all. Anyway, you were no good to me. You're no good to any woman.
Any brown sugar, he said.
No.
I'd have thought that Lord Thing kept brown sugar for his coffee. Lady Top Brass, Lady Brass Tops.
The groceries aren't in with the rent. They're provided by me. Well, by Charles. You can't get demerara in the village. She had to stop.
Darling, he said, coming over and taking her hands. Darling, for God's sake, don't. Don't cry. Whatever.
You're so bloody cruel. You always were so bloody cruel.
But truthful. He said, squeezing her hands so that they hurt. Always that. And to no one else. Not truthful like this.
Thank you very much.
Oh, Het, don't be cruel back. God, you were always crueller. You know you were, too. You could get in where it hurt because you knew. Where are you going?
He caught up with her as she reached the hall, at the foot of the stairs beside the telephone, which stood in the curl of the banisters, an old-fashioned telephone with a trumpet and a very old wire drooping out of it like a brown string chain.
Het,
he said, grabbing her. The telephone tottered and he caught it, and...
Marvellous, he said, looking at the telephone. God, it's nice, like a black daffodil. Does it work?
She flung off up the stairs, leaving him with the telephone next to his heart.
I'll go back to the pub then.
She answered by closing her bedroom door and heard him walk slowly down the weedy drive between the giant rhubarb, the wilderness of fuchsias to the great crumbling gateposts. Once, twice, she heard him stop. Savagely, delightedly, she imagined him looking back at the house all in darkness, her bedroom window dark as all the rest.
Don't move.
She put an arm across her forehead and looked out under it. He was drawing.
Shut your eyes again. Put your arm down, Het.
After a time, she said, Can I open them now? I want to see if the children... I fell asleep.
They're all right, he said. I can see them. They're shrimping in a pool. I've been drawing them, too.
However long have you been here?
About an hour. You were deep asleep, with the red ants walking all over you.
I don't believe that. The fisherman had a good look too. I didn't sleep much last night. You went to bed too soon. Hetty of the white, white skin. Here you are. You never were one to get sunburnt. He threw the drawing across to her. Hetty sleeping.
It's lovely.
And here's the children. Sophie's round, firm cheek, a sweep of eyelash, her wrist still with its fetal crease over the wrist top. Andy's long head, clear eyes, another drawing of his head from behind. The heart-breaking tail of hair left from babyhood, lying in the dent down the back of his neck.
Have you any children, Henniker?
No. He got up and loped towards the sea, and Sophie and Andy, seeing him nearby, sprang up to follow. She saw Andy show him something from a pool. Sophie lifted her arms to be picked up. Henniker, examining in one hand the object from the pool, swung Sophie up with his other arm onto his shoulder, and the three of them stood reflectively together, illuminated, at peace. Tomorrow, said Henniker, eating her sandwiches at lunchtime. It was too beautiful a day to go back to the house, too good for the children to waste in resting. Tomorrow we'll go to the Clifton show and see the ponies. We'll go on the bus.
Wherever the bus, she said.
To see some people.
Will you draw the people on the bus? Asked Andy.
I might.
But he didn't. They sat in a row on either side of the gangway, Hetty with Andy, Henniker with Sophie, who soon got on his knee, and listened to the talk around them and watched the sea and the bog and the procession of the Connemara Mountains, purple and graceful behind the orange gorse and the great scattering of white stones. At Clifton they walked the fair and touched the ponies and brought things and ate things and drank things and lived in the lovely crowd. Henniker, in washed-out blue denim, brown-faced, lanky as a cowboy with the two small children trotting behind him, turned heads. Hetty, carrying the picnic in a big round basket she had found among the fishing tackle in the house, in sandals and a handkerchief over her head, and a faded red dress bought years ago in Florence, walked easily along, feeling she might be taken for a tinker. Happy and weary at 5 o'clock, they caught the bus home. Sophie falling deep asleep in Henniker's arms, Andy moving over beside him. Hetty set the basket on the seat left empty beside her and, like a peasant, shielded her eyes from the levelling sun. Back at Henniker's pub, where the bus stopped, he lifted Sophie carefully down and put her in the back seat of Hetty's car. Andy stumbled in beside her, then stuck out his head. You coming back too, Henniker?
No, it's supper time at the pub.
Mummy could cook you some with us.
No, they'd be cross at the pub if I didn't turn up. It'll be ready.
Why would they? You could still pay. Why don't you come and stay with us? There's heaps of room. You could sleep next to Mummy.
His clear voice carried across the pub yard, and some people coming up from the beach looked amusedly at them. And a girl, the waitress or barmaid who had been leaning against the bar door, disappeared, slamming it behind her.
I can't do that, Henniker flicked Andy's nose. But you must go. It's been a long day.
Hetty started the car. He came round to her side of it and said,
I'll walk over later.
It was a question made to sound like a statement. Not looking at him but busily at the gears, she said, All right, and swung through the gate and up the hill. When the children were fed and in bed, drugged and rosy with sun, she bathed and changed, trying on first one thing and then another, ending up with a long cotton dressing gown. She put up her hair on top of her head, where it immediately began to fall down, rather successfully. She took off her shoes and wandered to the kitchen to find something for supper.
but nothing seemed to make her feel hungry. She ate a tomato by the fridge, staring through the kitchen window at the high, neglected grass and the tall evening primroses that slapped the pane. She laid the coffee tray. Then she walked to the sitting room and struggled half-heartedly with the faint fire. The sun, now setting in a blaze beyond the point, turned the room to glory, lighting up a filmy, silvery, peaty dust on the old furniture, making a great vase of flowers and leaves she had gathered yesterday glow rose-red. "It's like a dream," she thought. She walked all round the house and then into the garden, pacing its boundaries on her bare feet, discovering an overgrown fish pond, peering into the long empty stables with trees growing through the roofs, disturbing three lean sheep from under an old mounting block. She walked the long way back to the front door and stood a while, looking out to sea, and determinedly not towards the road. Then she went in and lit the kettle. Then she turned it off. She went up to look at the children, and coming down again, looked at last, unashamedly, down the long, empty drive. She went back to the sitting room and sat in the armchair and looked at the black turf on the fire. The sun had quite gone and the room was cold. It was 10:30. He was not coming. As she fell asleep, she saw a sudden image of Charles's alert and prudent face. She thought, Charles always saw me right home to the door. Hetty sleeping. She jumped with such a jerk, she felt quite sick and sat bolt upright. Henniker was opposite her in the other chair. He was laughing. Hetty, very deeply sleeping.
Where were you? Where am I? She cried. Henniker, it's midnight. Where have you been? It was 10 years ago, but where was the glass roof, the smell of Earl's Court? Where have you been? I've been all alone. She looked around. It was now. Ireland. The expensive rented house. Children. Charles somewhere in the world. Charles. The children, she said. I must see if the children are all right. The doors are all open. Anyone could have walked in.
It was I walked in.
But anyone could have. The IRA.
Don't be silly, Het.
You had no right to walk in.
You said I was to come.
But it's the middle of the night.
I was held up. It's a long walk here.
You've never been as late as this. She heard the voice, high, accusing. Oh, God, like a wife, like then. It's no different. Wearily she got up. I must go and look at the children, Henniker, and walked slowly away. But on the stairs she stopped, and after a while gave a sigh and turned and sat down, resting her head against the banisters. All the doors were open in the hall, and through the open front door on the right the moonlight flooded in, and the heavy, dementing scent of the nightflowers in the garden. She shut her eyes.
Het. He was at the foot of the stairs beside the ancient telephone. Het. He lifted his arm. Oh, my dear Het.
She pulled herself up and helplessly walked down back to him until she was two steps above him, level with his eyes.
Sleep with me, Hetty, he said.
And she said, of course. Between them on the banister, the telephone began to ring. It can't. It doesn't.
Well, it is.
It can't. It never has. It's terrible. She covered up her ears.
You'd better answer it.
I can't. I can't, she cried.
Well, I can't, can I? For God's sake, stop the bloody thing.
He walked over to the open front door. Looking at him all the time, she picked up the heavy earpiece and heard a tremendous crackling, then the voice of a sleepy postmistress, more crackling, and then from some ethereal wasteland, Charles.
Hester? Hester? Where on earth? God forsaken...
Here I am, she said. Yes. Charles?
Coming at once.
You're coming when?
I'll be there. More huge crackling. Over at last.
I didn't hear. When? Where are you? When are you coming?
The crackling grew and became a pain in the ears, then stopped. There was silence.
He's... Charles. He's on his way.
Where is he?
I don't know. Perhaps in Clifton.
At 12 o'clock at night? Well, he'd not get here till tomorrow if he's off a bus.
Perhaps he's even at Ballynish.
Don't be silly. Why bother to ring if you were already at Ballynish? He's probably still in Dublin, or more likely still in London, ringing from the Hilton, carousing with the clients.
No, no, you don't understand, Charles. I'm sure he's almost here.
He grabbed the phone and threw it on the ground and took her wrists and said,
Look, sleep with me.
I can't. I can't.
All right.
He walked back to the door. She watched him turn back to her. Behind his head was the dazzle of the sea.
There never was anyone but you, Het, he said, and was gone. Hester!
Charles's pleasant voice in the hall. Sounds of dropped luggage, Irish voices from the taxi. Half the village in attendance, much information being simultaneously imparted.
What a journey! What a place to get to!
Shrieks from Sophie and Andy. Daddy! Oh, fishing rods! Did you remember to bring my orange bag?
There are crabs, huge ones. Lobsters! We went to the fair.
She watched them from the stairs. Fickle, leaping like puppies. The taxi man. The taxi man's assistant. The taxi man's grandfather brooding by.
Hester! Thank God! Damn thing over. Come and give us a kiss.
The attendants were paid off.
How are you, love? Can't see you. Aren't there any lights? What's that thundering noise? Good heavens, what a telephone. Did I manage to get through on that?
The lights come and go, she said. The thundering does too.
I'll fix it, he said. The electrics will be the generator. I'll get on with it in a minute. It's very cold here.
We can't light the peat, said Andy.
But peat's marvellous, you useless creatures. I'll make a blaze. Where's the sitting room? Better turn off the stopcock for the present. We're going out to supper.
We can't. There's only the pub. You have to book. What's the matter with my voice?
I've booked.
But the places round here don't... Hardly ever, she said.
I stopped at the pub on the way, went in and booked. Come on, get the children out of their nightshirts. We're away to eat lobsters.
Charles, I can't go to the pub. I'm a mess. I'm tired. I waited all last night. We've waited around all day. It's after 8 o'clock.
All last night? You didn't expect me last night. I didn't ring till midnight. I was still in London. And, by the way, something else, he said, as he drove them all fast down the hill. The Bartletts are at the pub.
The Bartletts? From home? From Denham Place? Oh, no.
Yes. Have you got a sore throat? Said they saw you yesterday with some splendid man.
I didn't see them. I did, said Andy, when we dropped Henniker at the pub. Children are so odd, she said to Cathy Bartlett in the pub. Andy saw you yesterday, but he never said.
You seemed in a bit of a trance. Cathy Bartlett's eyes were careful. Charles's great laugh rang out at something Bartlett had said. They were alone in the pub dining room. A Bartlett child had come in from the television room and been gathered onto its mother's knee. But every knee is his knee. Every child is his child. Oh, Henniker. Oh, Henniker.
Famous chap, said Bartlett, the great artist, caused a stir. Oh, Henniker man, said Charles. Oh, that's it. Old flame of Hester's, eh?
Yes, said Hester.
I feel so far away. I was a student of his at the Slade. Oh, donkeys years ago. Oh, what can I do?
He's gone, asked Charles. Gone, all right. Disappear this morning. Barmaid's gone too, I believe. There's a great to-do. Well, he'd been with her every blessed night.
Oh, Noel, said Cathy.
Well, he had, be your age. These passages creak. We've not had a wink of sleep, Cathy and I, all week.
Don't blame her, anyway, said Cathy.
Gorgeous. Don't mind telling you, Hester.
She lit a cigarette expertly above her child's head. I was green with envy when I saw you with him on the beach. You ought to watch out, Charles.
Don't you worry, said Charles.
They got up to go. In Lord Thing's sitting room, the peat fire shone hot and bright. Charles brought in the tray and put it on the stool, then drew the curtains. He said,
I've settled the children, and I've had to make tea. I couldn't find any brown sugar.
I forgot it.
Never mind. Tea won't keep us awake. I say, what's this?
Hetty is sleeping. Give me that.
No, let me look. It's lovely. Wonderful.
It's mine. Charles, give it me. Give it me. Give it me.
No, he said. He held the drawing at a distance under the brilliant electric light. Hetty is sleeping.
He put on his glasses. Give me that. Give me that. Give me that.
Hetty's sleeping, he said, very sadly.
He put the drawing delicately down on Lord Thing's writing desk. Pouring tea for her, he said.
Sweet Hetty, wake up soon.
Lunch with Ruth Sykes. She was crying again last night, and that made it easier for me this morning. I said, I'm having lunch with Ruth Sykes today, dear. Hmm, she said, black coffee one hand, toast the other, peering down at the morning paper laid all across the kitchen table. She never sits down at breakfast. So, you'll be all right, dear. Hmm? For lunch, I mean, after surgery. I'll leave it ready in the oven, just to take out. What? Your lunch, dear, after surgery and your visits. It'll be in the oven. She looked at me through her big glasses. Such a big, handsome daughter. How could such a great big woman have come out of me? I'm so small. Jack was small too. And neither of us was anything much. Certainly nothing so clever as a doctor in either of the families, anywhere. It's funny. I look at her, my daughter, my Rosalind, and I can't believe she's the same as the baby I had. The fat, little, round, warm, bright-eyed thing holding its wrists up in the pram against the light, carefully watching the leaves moving in the birch tree, like a peaceful little fat cat. She's so bold and brave and strong now. Fast car, doctor's bag slung in the back, stethoscope, white coat, so quick on the telephone. Oh, it's wonderful to hear her on the telephone. Yes? When was this? All right, do nothing until I'm there. I'll be with you in 10 minutes. Oh, the life she must save. She's a wonderful doctor. But the crying is awful. It was really awful last night. Why can't you be here, Mother? Flicks over page of the Telegraph, peers closer. She never lets herself go, even when she's happy. I think the last time I remember her being overwhelmed in any way by feeling happy was when she got into Oxford. And then she just opened the telegram and said, Oh, my goodness, and spilled a whole cup of coffee all down her school uniform, all over the clean floor. I'm having lunch with Ruth Sykes. She finished her coffee. Bye, she says. Have a nice time. See you for supper. Oh,
No, I won't. Forgot. I'll be at the hospital. Till when, dear? God, I don't know. 10, 11? All right, dear. The road outside, as well as the front garden and the house, is diminished without her. Energy has gone out of the morning. I go back into the kitchen and start clearing up the breakfast. Am I really going? Dare I? I wash things up and stand for a time looking at the china cupboard door before putting them away. I go upstairs and change into my dark blue wool suit and good shoes and stockings and look at my face in the glass. It is a very silly face, like an unintelligent bird. Birds are supposed to have intelligent faces, but I don't know. Mine is like a bird's, but not a very bright bird. A sea stream bird. It's a timid, self-conscious face, ready to be made an ass of. An ass to be made of a bird. Rosalind does make me feel such an ass. She didn't as a baby. She used to get hold of bits of me then, my ear or my chin, and hang on tight and laugh and laugh. It does seem a pity. Anyway, I'm better looking than Ruth Sykes. I'm not an ass when I'm with Ruth Sykes either. I'm perfectly easy. We were at school together, and she was nothing like so clever as I was, though I was nothing special at all. I wish I were having lunch with Ruth Sykes. I'm not, though. I decided a fortnight ago, and I'm not losing my nerve now. No, I'm not. Not with all the crying. I'm going to London to see Michael. The crying didn't start as soon as Michael stopped coming here. She was quite sane and calm and quiet at first, even rather nice to me. I remember she said, would I like to go to the theatre with her once, and I got tickets for the two of us for Rose and Cavalier, just locally. It's not my favourite at all, and I expect she loathed it. But we sat there together very friendly, side by side. Is Michael busy tonight? I hadn't realised then. Spect so, she said. She didn't stay in at home, though, not at all, and she never mentioned him. She kept on being very nice to me for several weeks. Sometimes she'd come and sit by me and watch the telly for a bit, and once, I remember, she said she liked my dress. Once she seemed to be looking at me as if she was going to say something, and I just waited. I was so afraid of doing the wrong thing. I talk far too much, you see. I'm a bit of a joke the way I talk once I get started. She didn't say anything, though, and all I said after a day or two more was that Michael hadn't telephoned lately and were they going on holiday together again this summer, and she just got up and slammed out. Then that night I heard her crying. Awful, awful long sobs. They woke me up and I couldn't think whatever they were. Like terrible sawing noises, seconds apart. I went out onto the landing and they seemed to be coming from the top floor where she sleeps. And I went running up and stood outside her door. Awful sobs. Well, I daren't, of course, go in. I went down again to my floor and back to bed with the door open and listened. Just shaking. My eyes wide open, trying to imagine her face, all so smooth and assured, twisted up in the dark with the mouth crooked and those awful noises coming out of it. Yet at breakfast she was just the same, coffee cup one hand, toast the other, peering down at the newspaper. Perhaps two lines had appeared above the nose, creased together. That was all. Sit down, dear. You'll strain your eyes. She didn't answer. I got up in a sudden rush and went all round the table and I put my arm round her waist. She's so much taller than me. And I said, darling, can't you sit down a minute?
She said, "Oh, for God's sake, Mother," and pulled away. I said, "You'll hurt your eyes." "Is there any moment of the year," she said, "when you don't say that? Do you think," she said, "that just once you could express a single original thought?" I didn't hear her crying for a while, and then 3 weeks ago it began again. For a week she was crying every single night. I got up each time. At first I walked round my room bumping things about. Then I took to going out onto the landing and clicking on and off the light. Once I pulled the lavatory chain. The crying just went on. In the end, like last night, I took to going and sitting on the stairs outside her bedroom. It did no good, of course, but it was all I could do, and so I did it. I took the eiderdown and put it round me, and I just sat there, praying she would stop. Sometimes I told myself stories that she would come out and trip over me and say, "Oh, Mother," and then I would hug her and say, "Oh, Rosalind, what happened? Tell me what happened. What happened to him?" She never did. The crying always stopped in the end, longer pauses between the sobs, and then when the idiot birds began to wake up, she'd be quiet at last. So funny. When she was a baby, that was the time she would always wake up. She got a real nuisance about 1.5, and I had to be quite firm. I used to go in, and she'd be standing in her cot with her nappies round her ankles and her nightie all frills and her face like a rose. "Now, Rosalind, back to sleep. Too soon, baby. It's only 5 o'clock. The day hasn't started yet." "But the birds has begun to tweet," she said. Oh, she was lovely. "The birds has begun to tweet." And she wasn't two. Still in nappies. I still tell that story, I'm ashamed to say. I oughtn't to, because I know she hates it. She glares and stamps out, or even worse, she withers me with an icy stare. "I wonder how many times Ruth Sykes has heard that story," she says. Well, I know I'm a fool. Our doctor thought I was a fool all right a couple of weeks ago when I went to see him and said I had a bad heart and wanted to see a heart specialist. "Well, well, Mrs. Thessaly," he said, "shall I be the judge of that? What does your daughter say?" "I haven't told her," I said. "I don't want her to know. But I am sure myself and I want to see a specialist. I want to see Dr. Michael Kerr. He's not the man I usually use. And anyway, let's have a look at you and see if we need to use anyone." He examined me and said he was glad to say that we need not use anyone. "Perfectly normal heart, it seems to me. Very good for your age. What are you, 50? 52? No signs of trouble at all." But I went on and on at him. I do rather go on and on when I'm not with Rosalind. And then I hardly speak. "Look, my dear, I can't send you up to Harley Street with absolutely nothing wrong with you," he said. "My daughter says that 3/4 of the people she sees have absolutely nothing wrong with them. It's all in their minds." "This is my mind," I said. "I can't get it out of my mind." "Not sleeping?" he said. "No." That was true anyway. "Eating? Not much." "Something worrying you?" he said, putting his fingertips together and looking over them like an advertisement for medical insurance. Whatever use in the world would it be to tell him? "My heart," I said at last. "I know I'm being a fool. I have big blue eyes. As a matter of fact, I notice that if I look at people steadily with my eyes open wide and think very honestly of what I have just said, they often smile at me as if I had given pleasure." The doctor did now. "All right," he said, undoing his fingertips. "We'll give you a letter for Dr. Michael Kerr and make an appointment. I had it in my handbag now, and I carried my handbag with great care as I went to the tube station and took the train to Oxford Circus. I had a hat on and good gloves and pearl studs in my ears, though only Woolworth's. I walked to Michael's nursing home, calm as calm, and one or two people, one of them a tall black man with a lovely smile, noticed me and I smiled back, particularly at the black man, who looked kind. I didn't feel so good in the hospital, though. There was a dreadful woman behind the reception desk. "For Dr. Kerr," she said, and looked at me as if nobody as insignificant as me had a right to see Michael. "Are you private?" "No, not really," I said. "But I am today." "I'm sorry, I don't understand. I'm National Health, but I didn't think it was right to see Dr. Kerr on the National Health, because my doctor doesn't think there's anything wrong with me, so I insisted on paying." Up shot her neat pencilled eyebrows. "I see," she said. "Another nutter. Will you sit over there and wait, please?" She took my letter and opened it and smoothed it out and pinned it on a board and read it. Had she the right to do that? I must ask Rosalind. But this was something I couldn't ask Rosalind. This was very private. Rosalind would never know. I was private today, all right. The receptionist looked closely at me now and then with gleaming eyes, and I tried to look at other things. I looked at two doors marked males and females. They had been newly painted over. You could still just see where ladies and gentlemen had been. Males and females looked dreadful somehow, like a zoo. I have always dreaded and hated hospitals, though Rosalind, of course, doesn't know. I kept looking at the notices and thinking, this is why, though I couldn't begin to tell you what I meant. "Would you come this way, please, Mrs. Cecily?" A nice, frizzy nurse, as fat as Rosalind was when she was a baby, took me along to a waiting room. And then, after another minute, a pure, thin Chinese nurse came out of a door and held it open and said, "Come in, Mrs. Thessaly." I tried to get up, but was unable to move. "This way, Mrs. Thessaly." Still I sat. She came across and said, "Come along, Mrs. Thessaly. Dr. Kerr doesn't bite," and laughed, showing little neat teeth. And there I was, sitting in front of a desk the size of a tennis court, and there, behind it, sat Michael, who used to be always having supper with us, making funny faces at me through the kitchen window as he came round by the back door, making me drop the teapot. Weeding the garden for me, looking at his watch and saying, "Where is the woman? Why does your daughter work so hard? Why isn't she coming to play tennis?" 2 years and more Michael had been in our lives. He looked older, grimmer and even bigger in his white coat. He had glasses, that was new, and he was reading my notes with the same drawn-down expression Rosalind has now. "Now then," he said, "Mrs.... I sat. "Mrs. Thessaly," he said, and I sat looking at my hands in the good gloves. I didn't look at him any more. All that I needed to know, I knew. I knew it from the horrified, upward-rising inflection of his voice. "Mrs. Thessaly?" And there on the table was the note from my own doctor, saying that there was nothing wrong with me, but that I had insisted on seeing him and only him. I knew there and then how terribly I had blundered. And, as with Rosalind, and as never before with dear Michael, I was quite unable to speak. A nurse creature came in and said, "So sorry, doctor, could you just sign these?" And he did. She went out. He moved the ashtray and things on the tennis court about and cleared his throat. I could hear the small tick of the little gold clock on the shelf behind him, one of Rosalind's birthday presents. The door burst open behind and someone called, "Oh, sorry, could I have a quick word?" and a young, carefree-looking houseman came in with coat and stethoscope flapping. "I say, Mrs. Arnold's doing well," Michael said. "Oh, yes. Marvellous. She could go out today, I think." "You wouldn't think if you'd seen her last night. She collapsed."
"What?"
"Yes. We were with her 2 hours."
"Oh, God, nobody told me."
"Then it's just as well you saw me, isn't it? I hope you haven't told her."
"What?"
"That she can go home today."
"No, no.
She needs a good bit of care."
The houseman vanished and the door closed. Michael got up and went and stood looking out of the window, and I got up too. "I'd better go," I said. He said nothing. I got to the door, and I just had to look round at him. And there was his familiar shape, made so godlike and all-powerful by its setting, larger than life. So different from when it used to be crawling in and out of my delphiniums, setting slug pellets and calling down curses on my absent, overworking, non-tennis-loving daughter. Oh, how ever had I dared?
"Mrs. T," he said to the distant chimney pots of Bayswater. "This is absolutely none of my doing, I want you to know. Nothing at all can come from me. I think that since Rosalind clearly hasn't told you, then I should. It is very much all over."
"Female," I said.
"What?" he said, turning round.
"Female." I was thinking of the awful notices on the door outside. I don't know that I really knew what I was talking about, but I went on. "She couldn't come to you, you know. I know all the equality and things, and she does seem to be so completely a doctor. But there are still very deep conventions." He frowned and swung away and looked out of the window again. "There are things a woman can't do. It's so odd, but she can't. Unless she's a man-woman. It has nothing to do with status, women's lib and so on. It is an instinct. Rosalind would never, never write or ring you up, unless for a death or something. She would let all you have had together go before..." And I was gone, out of the room, out of the waiting room, out of the hospital, back into Oxford Street, and my heart was beating so loud. It was probably making more noise than Mrs. Arnold's, who'd collapsed. I seemed to be crying, too. I walked the whole length of Oxford Street, looking in all the shop windows, and what was in them all, I don't know. When I got to Tottenham Court Road, there was a huge cinema, and I bought a ticket and went in. It seemed to be a film made for giants. The screen was so big you had to turn your head to get it all in. Enormous people came bounding out of it at you, singing at the top of their voices. Happy children, nuns who became governesses and married princes and escaped from the Germans, and sang and sang and sang. What curious lives people lead. There were very few people in the cinema. An old woman in my row was fast asleep, and the only other person was a greasy young man with his feet up on the seat in front, who kept on getting up and going back to buy ice creams. At the end of the film, when there seemed to be some sort of a royal wedding going on, I got up and went out and found it was quite dark. And I thought I would look for a cup of tea. But I walked all down Bloomsbury Way without finding one, and at the end of it I found I was standing instead on the steps of an hotel. It was a very busy, ugly-looking hotel, with a lot of students sitting about in the foyer with haversacks, and the carpets very threadbare and not clean. And without knowing what on earth I was about to do, I pulled the glass doors open and went in, and booked a room for the night. It was £6 in advance, and I paid out of my purse and went upstairs. I lay on the bed, which was narrow and hard, and looked at the ceiling. What is the good of it, suffering like this for her, I thought. And I was so tired I hadn't even taken off my shoes. After all, I thought, it isn't me. I must have fallen asleep then, because it was suddenly very still,
and from something in the silence and the blackness of the window, it was obviously the middle of the night. I sat up and felt frightened and dazed for a moment until I remembered where I was. Then I found my thoughts had not moved on. Though my watch said 3 a.m., I was still saying, "Why suffer so? It's not me. It's not my affair." I began to think in a way I'd never thought before in all Rosalind's 27 years. I thought of the breakfasts, when she never looked in my direction. The months and months and months when she was only a hurried figure appearing for meals, retiring to her study, rushing out to see to others. For all the years when, except for Ruth Sykes and Mrs. Somebody in the Road or Uncle James at Hastings, because we've so few relatives, and since Jack died, I've not had much interest in friends and going about, all the years when every telephone call and letter and message and inquiry and invitation has always been for her. I thought of her great big handsome face that never smiles at mine, the way she winces whenever I open my mouth, the way she so clearly despises me, of how the only time she had ever softened at all into the Rosalind of long ago and before Jack died was when Michael was there. And she had never actually invited Michael, now I came to think of it. He had found his own way to us, first just dropping her at the gate or picking her up, usually too early for her. "Oh, Lord, sorry," she had always said, bursting in on us as we sat together talking, or Michael weaving about, looking under saucepan lids in the kitchen. "It's all right," he'd say. "Your mamma and I have been enjoying ourselves." I remembered the slight surprise I had seen in her face sometimes at this remark, the frequent quick look at me to see what I was wearing, and relief if it was something she didn't think ghastly. As the dawn began to make the sky grow pale and dirty over Bloomsbury, I realised that, after all, I didn't like Rosalind very much. And as I fell asleep and the local sparrows began to tweet, I said clearly and out loud, "I have had enough. Ah, oh, I have had enough." When I woke about 9:30, I washed in the nasty little basin, but only my face and hands, and not with any real interest, and still just in the same old suit I had slept in, I went downstairs and I sat for a time in the foyer. There were more students about than ever, getting hot drinks in paper cups out of a machine on the wall. I felt out of place in my hat and gloves and pearl studs, and rather faint in all the bustle and heat. A gingerish little girl of about 18 or 19 flopped down on the seat beside me and began to read a map of London. She knocked my arm. "Oh, I'm sorry," she said. "Oh, are you all right?" "If I gave you the money," I said, "could you get me a cup of tea out of the machine?" She got it and came and stood over me while I drank it with a serious, earnest face. "Are you all right?" she said. "Shall I get someone?" She asked like a child asking someone wiser. "No, dear," I said. "Thanks so much, though." A funny, ordinary little thing, the sort I might have had. The sort, really, you'd expect Jack and me to have had. The sort I wish... I went out into Bloomsbury Way and into Museum Street and thought I might go to the British Museum, but the street looked very long, and I didn't seem to make any great progress down it. I felt really most odd. "I shall buy a present for that poor Mrs. Arnold," I said to someone passing, who looked alarmed. A bus passed very close to me at some lights. I felt the wind of it. It blew my skirt against me. A taxi driver yelled at me as I had just made the curb. I thought, I suppose I should really be more careful, and perhaps I should move on now. What I meant by move on was left for my subconscious to decide, and I was pleased that it did, relieving me of responsibility. It directed me to Russell Square tube station and suggested that I descend. I changed, or I suppose I changed, at a couple of stations, because in an unspecified time, an hour or a day, I found that the train had stopped at Putney Bridge. I was home, it seemed. I got out. Now, our house is in one of those streets to the right of Putney High Street and a long walk from either Putney Bridge or the High Street station. Even a bus doesn't take you very near. You have to get across the High Street too at the outset, and that isn't nothing on a Saturday morning. "Look alive!" someone shouted as I dithered on an island. I made the further shore and I trudged on. I trudged down Lacey Road and Corpore Terrace. On I trudged past all the plum and purple houses, row upon row, with names like Quantox and East Lynn. Jack was so fond of Putney. I never liked it much. Perhaps I'll move. I'll just go away. Well, really, it's very silly just waiting hand and foot on a great 27-year-old woman you don't like and who doesn't like you. The elastic went in my locknits. I've always worn locknits. Briefs and loose legs are not nice on anyone my age, and I like a gusset. They have the old-fashioned elastic, which you can still get at the Home and Colonial. Very reliable and long-lasting, whatever Rosalind says. Never before in all the years has the elastic broken and the knicker leg begun to fall. Then I turned into R Road and I saw the police car. And I ran. I ran past Mrs. Ferguson at number 63, though she was waving her arms about and calling, and Mrs. Atkinson next door was calling too, standing in her front garden and looking over at our house. It didn't seem like our road at all, somehow. Very lively, it seemed, and myself at the centre of things, my knicker leg hanging. Then a policeman came out of our house and Michael with him, talking together. And then I knew. There and then, at once, I knew. She had killed herself. She had cried last night and come out of her room to the bathroom and got all the aspirins and killed herself. The one night I had not been on the landing waiting, the one night in all her life I had abandoned her and ceased to care. A suicide note. Michael's name on the envelope. Michael summoned to the house by the police. And then I was lying flat on my back on my own sitting-room sofa with three faces looking down at me. One I had not seen before, a policeman's, very young and sensible. One was Michael's face, and one, oh God, oh God, oh God be thanked, was Rosalind's. And her face was all wet and streaming all round and under the glasses, and she seemed to be shouting in a fierce and furious way, yelling. Yelling, where were you? Where were you? How could you? The policeman shook hands with Michael, who saw him, I suppose, to the door, while Rosalind's maniac yelling went on. We thought you were dead. We thought you were dead under a car. Michael came in and got her by the shoulders and shook her. Shut up at once and go and get your mother some tea. Sobbing like a great booby, she went, and I sat up. And Michael and I looked at each other. Oh, Michael, I'm so sorry. I shouldn't have interfered. It was nothing to do with me. I don't know what I was thinking. Hush, he said. He sat down on a stool and took my hand, and we sat quiet. I rang Ruth Sykes. Don't pretend you were with Ruth Sykes, Rosalind cried, hurtling in with a milk jug. Out of our minds with... Oh, good heavens! Knicker leg! She shrieked. She disappeared, and there was a great noise of crockery crashing in the kitchen. Oh, dear, I said. She's so hopeless. I'd better go. Hush, he said. She rang, he said. She rang this morning. So I was even wrong about that. No, he said. She left a message, she said. It is my mother. It is a matter of life and death. You said,
only if it were a death.
Well, it wasn't, I said.
From the look of you at the moment, it might have been.
Oh, Michael, I'm sorry. I didn't want to make you feel you had to come running.
I didn't. I decided yesterday I'd come back, after you'd gone. They caught me leaving for here after she'd rung off. I was leaving when she phoned, but she doesn't know that. She said, "Oh, how quick you've been," when she opened the door. I felt not commendable. I closed my eyes, for it was all too difficult. Then in flew Rosalind again with a tray of oddments, the old brown teapot and three stray cups. She'd taken off her glasses, and her hair was falling down, and her cheeks were bright pink right up close under the eyes, all roses, like a child again. She really is a lovely girl.
"How could you?" she was still crying out. "Out of my mind! You've never, ever! Whenever did you?" and so on.
Michael stretched up his other hand and took hers and said, "Hush," again. "Let your poor mother rest," he said. "I've never met such an emotional pair. If you don't both stop, I'll have to call a doctor."
"Oh, don't try to be funny, Michael, but..."
"Hush," he said again. "Your poor mamma is going to need all the strength she's got to organise this wedding." And Rosalind poured a whole cup of tea all down the front of her dress and onto the floor and dropped the cup and smashed it. The last of the Worcester. And she just gazed at him. "It beats me," he said, but gazing back at her with such joy. "It beats me, medically," he said, "genetically, and I shall tell Ruth Sykes. It beats me how such an intelligent woman could produce such a stupid great child."
The Great Grand Soapwater Kick. Now and then you get to get washed. Now and then you start needing bath. Not often, every second year maybe. Comes over you, sudden. You begin to think, "Hello now. Sun hot. You see big toe looking out a slit boot, yellowish grey, like ivory on elephant. People start moving away. I'm tramp, see? Oboe, dropout, gentleman of road, swagman, tramp. May have seen me on road any day, 15 years. Push pram along, full gear. Got long black coat, rags, other clothes under. These, not see for many years at time. Not observed. Between these and skin lining newspapers. The news is old. Keep all about me, day, night, pushing pram. Stop. Have good burrow. Rubbish bins. Sleep, park, steps, cinema, back church, back seat, parked car. Places, people, gleaming faces. Nothing do. And soup, bread. Grand what pick up to. Name, Horser. Daft, silly woman, mother. Dead all I know. Hengist, dead too. Julius Caesar, dead. Napoleon, Churchill, Harry Pollitt, Hitler, dead. Also, 60, maybe 70, give take a year. Never count up. Until start thinking wash. Comes on like said, slow, slow. Hot day, wash. Water, wash. Wash, bath, soak, steam. Grand. When boy, town called, never mind, Mugstown, Mutstown. One good thing, bath. Oh boy, someone scrubbing away ears, back, toenails, pure pink, white, shiny, not elephant slab grey. So,
Go this day down road, town, maybe Mugs Town, Mutts Town, all I know. Get there over hill, through wood, up village, out village, and it was raining. My rain. Deepest paper underlinings, wet as something soggy. Rain turned snow. Horser shacks up barn. Farmer looks, get out there, you, or I'll get me gun. So, push off. Pram sticks every 10 yards, icy mud. Sits down, splat. Great good for nout, yells farmer. Fire in hay, bloody fags. No fags, says horser. Don't smoke, farmer. But comes out bad. Burble, wobble, yah, blah, splot. Tramp, see. Loner. No practice, mouth, tongue. Vocal cordage of sarcophagus. Bad words, filth, yells farmer. Also steps on, staggers on. That night, hedge back. Bath idea begins rise. Begins simmer. Dog comes up, sniffs, howls, runs off. Bit high, horser. On high, horser. Time go. What do is this? Look for house, good class, empty. Look, see water pipes growing up walls. Pass now again, maybe week, and watch what goes. He goes out, kids out, she goes out. 12 o'clock, she back. Maybe Fridays or some days, she always later. Maybe tea time, maybe keep fit, yoga, coffee, Mugs Town, friends. So, after 2 Friday, on Friday 3, in nips horser. First, hide in pram out house, garden shed. Find way, bathroom, start in. Oh, boy. So, finds this house. Oh, very nice. Very good class person. Green grass of Mugs Town, well cut, metal edges. Keep grass, not feeling too full of self. Keep place. Gravel paths of mustard yellow. Windows, white nets. Swags like in a tent. Front door, smart, box suites. Good chain for pool bell. He goes out. Kids go out. She goes out. Big bag. So out all Mugs Town day. Up steps goes smelly horser. Pulls chain bell. Now, if one comes... One gran, one serving maid, one lodger, one mad aunt kept close within, says horser, be so good, give poor tramp glass water. Which sings out, wobble, bubble, splash, woos, blot, pot. And horser screamed upon, yelled upon, scourged upon, sent on way. But if no answer, then it's the great grand soap water kick. Oh, boy! So, up steps, pram hidden safe below. Nobody about. Road dead, 9:30 o'clock of the morning. Nice quiet houses, nice quiet burglar alarm red boxes just stand. Inside each, all tables, chairs, clocks, pictures sit looking each other, warm, clean, out of wind, rain, weather. Poor sods. Up steps smelly horser. Rings bell. No answer. Rings again. No answer. Rings again. Turns. Look up, down. Not living soul. Not motor car. Not bike. Only cat. Gatepost. Watch through yellow slits. Cat stands. Stretches on 4 fat sixpences. Turns round. Curls up again. Go sleep. Carry on, horser. Have bath. Like cats. clean. Interesting. Round back house. Kitchen window open. Thought, silly woman. Right. Water taps inside window knobbly. Window small. Horser big. Huge. Elephant horser. Horser the elephant tramp. Horser the year. Oboe drop out. Gentleman road. Swagman. Scrappy. Tramp. Oh, boy. Maybe you left something else open, like perhaps back door? Don't be daft, Orser. Not your luck, and you are lucky. Kick three milk bottles and one little disc. Disc says, three more, please. Shatter, shatter, shatter! Sounds Orser killed street greenhouses. Stand still. All well. No alarm. Change disc. 27 more, please. Very funny joke. Try back door. And back door open. Hallelujah, horser! In go, upstairs, right in bathroom. Big lump pink soap, size bread loaf. Rose pink. False teeth pink. One, two, three, four towels, big, thick, hanging on fat, hot, coppery pipes. Oh, boy! Also works taps, drops in plug. Bath, pale rose pink, baby pink, Mugstown pink, fills up, up. Three jars, salts, green, yellow, lilac. Lilac, favourite colour. Lilac. Pour whole jar lilac in very hot bath and steam rise. Smells gardens, heaven. Off come horser boots. Hard work, but off come. In time.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.